My name is Larry Reagan. I'm one of the directors of the Center for Online Innovation and Learning. And I'm going to do a bit of an introduction in a moment to our guest speaker today. I really appreciate you folks turning out here on campus when I said it's so beautiful outside. I also want to make sure I'm welcoming our online guests. And hopefully it's beautiful wherever you are as well. We're using a slightly new tool for a COIL talk today. We're using MediaSite Live, which has some different interaction capabilities. So you'll notice on your window, for those of you who are joining us virtually, that there is a chat bubble. So if you have any questions or comments, we're going to use my colleague Brad here in the front row to channel those questions and comments to our speaker. So go ahead, feel free to type anything in that box. Brad will intercept those. Do let me tell you, however, it's not an interactive chat, so Brad really won't be able to talk back with you in that sense. It's kind of a one-way delivery system, okay? So again, thank you for joining us physically and virtually. I was trying to remember the number. I want to say this might be our 15th, I'm kind of guessing, COIL Fischer talk. We started in 2012. The intention behind this program is to bring international and national experts, thought leaders to Penn State to engage at a variety of levels in our community in order to stimulate our thinking about bigger worlds. And I met Donald probably 5 years ago or more at a program that we were both participating in London, and I was immediately kind of drawn to his thinking and his vision. I've since followed up, and you can see it up here on the board in his blog, Plan B. He's got a very interesting way, he's a little entertaining, but also a very informative way of looking at trends in the world. And so I use it as one of my go-to spots for keeping up with things. So I found out maybe in June or so that Donald was going to be in the States. He lives not too far. He's in the UK, I want to say near London, Brighton. And I thought, oh, here's maybe an opportunity. Reached out. Donald said he'd love to come to Penn State, and arrived yesterday on one of our big 747s, by the way, you know, the little puddle jumpers we refer to. So it's a pleasure to have him in. By way of background, let me just tell you, Donald was a CEO. He's a serial entrepreneur, starting up new industries primarily, he told us this morning, always in the EdTech space, which is really exciting for us. He was one of the original founders of the Epic Group, a leading company in the UK for online learning. And his latest venture, which I think we're going to hear about today, is called Wildfire. I'm not going to give you a whole bunch of background. 30 years in the field in a variety of educational business ventures, a real thought leader, I think, somebody I look to for, as I said, some guidance and direction of where everything's going. I love this, though, on his page, he describes himself as free from the tyranny of employment. So it gives him a great deal of flexibility to pursue interests and not be tied to a particular channel, if you will, or a thought, somebody else's thought processes. These are his own. So with that, let me introduce and welcome Donald to the stage.
Thank you, Larry.
Pleasure.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. I just had a chat with these guys. If you're wondering what this accent is, it's Scottish. Not Irish or Welsh, but Scottish. I arrived in the States a couple of days ago on the 7th, which was an auspicious day. So I was here on your election day. I was teaching at the University of Pennsylvania. And I showed them this slide, okay? So I'm going to be talking about these three things. They're all two letters. I'm going to sort of relate them in many ways in learning. But why does AI, in particular, I'm going to be talking a lot about AI because I think that's much bigger than VR or AR. And this is the slide I started with. This was the morning of the election, okay? And I wanted to tell people a little bit about my adventures in AI and why I think it's important and why it matters for your lives. There's an Indian AI company called Mog AI who for the last three presidential elections got it right on the money with regard to who the president was going to be. And in October of this year, on my blog, I predicted that Trump would win. I did the same, in September, then October, and it was based on the AI data that these guys had. Because what they did was they didn't use Alexander Graham Bell's telephone, that old 19th century technology to poll people. They were basically harvesting data, using AI to harvest, then analyze data from Twitter, Facebook, and Google. And of course, that's much more accurate mathematically and statistically than any of these pollsters, which is why they got it wrong. Same happened in my country with Brexit. They got it completely wrong. AI has absolutely transformed that world and comes up with very powerful insights if it's used well. So the morning I said that Trump was going to win, none of the people, there were 27, and these were all quite senior business people, none of them believed that it was right. They were laughing. They were laughing, really. But I think it's a proof point in the sense of the efficacy of this stuff and why it really matters. If this technology is that powerful, then let's think about it. Another little data mining exercise here. There's an economist called Branovich who I really like. He worked at the World Bank, and he's a real AI data guy as well. And he came up with this quite a famous curve in economics now called the elephant curve. And it's an example of the power of AI again. So along this axis here, okay, you go from poorest to richest. So this is like people in really poor countries, largely in Africa, who are stuck in this trap of not getting their income up here. This is median income coming up here. Right up here, you have China. You suddenly have hundreds of millions of poor people suddenly getting a rise in their net income, okay, right across the board. Not only China, but the Far East as well. Where do you think this is? These are the people who voted for Trump. They found that their median income has fallen. This data is very interesting. It's called the elephant curve. And these are the super rich up here. Look how they shot up here. Woof. So throughout the world, the rich are coining it. And your blue-collar workers and increasingly white-collar workers are in this dip. So it came as no surprise. There's another guy, as an economist at the World Bank, who predicted a Trump victory as well. And you may, again, related to Branovich, the graph he shows a lot as well, you may think that Trump was right, that manufacturing has fled south, but the data doesn't say that at all. Actually, manufacturing in the US, manufacturing output is this red line, has been steadily climbing. Manufacturing is a huge thing in America, second only to China, still massive, much bigger than the next three manufacturing countries put together. But look at the red line, that's jobs. Sorry, the blue line. Okay? So you're still producing loads of stuff, but you need far less people. Why do you think that is? Why do you think you need less people? Because of technology. Because of technology. It's being automated out. You think that's going to stop? No way. In fact, with AI, it will accelerate. It will become logarithmic, the effect. Because it won't just affect people in factories, it will affect all those people who work in offices. So America was an agrarian population in the early 19th century. People worked on the land, in the fields. That was automated. They went to work in the factories. That's been automated. They're now going to work in offices. Management, that's going to be automated. But they have nowhere to go. That's the end spot. There is nothing else. So we're facing some big political challenges. So the younger people in this audience, I hope you rise to that challenge and it doesn't end in disaster. I personally think that AI might also have the solution. It's like the god Shiva, and my Indian friend, the god Shiva both creates and destroys. I think as it destroys, we have to look at using AI for good, which is why I think the use of AI in learning is important. We will have more leisure time in the future. We are going to have to learn more quicker. I think that's one of the solutions. We'll come at that in a minute. One thing I would really recommend you read if you're interested in this, this is one of Obama's last acts. This came out of the White House 3 weeks ago, and it's a report on the future, the impact of AI on the American economy and culture in general. A really brilliantly written document, I have to say, for a government report. I've read a lot of these. This was really stunningly good. Interesting couple of recommendations in here about student learning outcomes and training programs. In fact, that was Obama sitting there. A lot of research right across government saying, get on and start using this stuff in education, because that really matters. That's a social good. Okay, that's why I'm here today. And this is why this matters. It's not a trivial issue. But let me jump into VR. I promised to give you a little bit of VR stuff as well, because I think this is really interesting. You know, I'm sitting here looking at you all in 3D. The world is 3D, but almost all learning is in 2D. Flat pages, flat video, flat Wikipedia, flat screens. There's something odd there, isn't there? And that's only because we haven't had the technology that's given us a 3D world in the past. Suddenly, out of nowhere, comes almost every major tech company in the world has an offer, from Apple, Microsoft, Oculus and Facebook, PlayStation, you name it. They've all got platforms here because this is a new medium. This is not a gadget. This is a brand new medium, like film, like television, like writing. And if you've ever experienced VR, you'll know that it can really sort of amaze you in terms of the sort of cognitive shock. I want to show, this was something I did 2 years ago with my sister. It's one of these sort of, you know, somebody freaking out in VR, but I want to show you it for a good reason. It's always fun. Now, she's in a roller coaster, standard stuff in VR. You've probably all done one of these things, okay? But have you ever been involved in a lecture or a learning experience where you've been so excited? No way. Okay? Now, watch this bit. Just round the corner. She came into the bend there, okay? And if she really believes she's there, she's not in that room. She's absolutely on that thing, okay? Full attention. Now I'm going to take her on a bungee jump, and this is where it gets interesting. She's never done one before. I think we can get the volume up on this. So I take her to the edge, okay? And there's a 500-foot drop in her mind, but it looks like a 500-foot drop. She looks around, there are people behind her going, jump, jump, which freaks her out a bit. She actually waves to them, she thinks they're sort of real. So I'm walking out of the edge. Right, that's my niece. And off she goes. She's falling. And she is falling in her mind. And she's upside down on the bungee cord. Okay? I had to pixelate that, I'm afraid. Not for public consumption. I actually put it on YouTube. She wasn't happy with me. Okay, this is 2 years ago. This technology's really come on now. But I don't know about you. I said that before. I've demonstrated this all over the world in Africa and all sorts of places, and everybody has this reaction. There's no cultural difference whatsoever. It's a mind-blowing thing. But why does that matter to us? That's actually what she saw. She was coming to the end of a walkway, 500 feet right down here. And she felt it for real. You sort of feel the G-forces. All sorts of weird things happen here on this stuff because this is a medium, a new medium, and try it if you can because it's a wonderful thing. So all of these players are in the market now, and I wouldn't worry about who's going to be the winner, who's not going to be the winner, but basically you can have everything from a mobile thing that's untethered so you can walk around the room. The trouble with Google Cardboard is you have to use your hand to keep it on your face, as it were, but they've come up with a sort of really lightweight felt one. You've got Oculus with a hand manipulation, so you can lift objects. I've been involved in projects where you're actually doing engineering tasks, where you're actually screwing things, putting them together, building things for real. Of course, we've got Galaxy Gear. We've got all sorts of weird stuff happening. Vive up the top there as well. The PlayStation 1, so if you've got PlayStation, this is going to be really a games console, but again, manipulating weapons and so on, and shoot 'em ups. So everybody's playing this game now. Why is it interesting to anybody who's involved in learning, in other words, students or faculty here? Well, there are some principles in the psychology of learning that really do matter. Number one is attention, right? I've got a prop here, this damn thing here. The brain. I got this in a shop in Brighton, where I live. I went into the shop and they had a pile of these, and I went, who buys this shit? You know, like, who buys brains? And I there suddenly realized I was the only person who probably wanted a brain at that point. But there are some big problems with this organ. And if you're a teacher, you'll know what those problems are. One, it's almost impossible to get everybody's attention for more than about 5 to 10 minutes because somebody's jived out onto Facebook or whatever. But attention is a necessary condition for learning. And when you've got VR on, it's not like the cinema. You can't pop out, get your popcorn, slip your coat. You are there. It holds your attention for long periods. So think about that as a teacher. The second one is the emotional or affective intensity in learning, which is often missing from a 1-2-hour lecture. Let's face it, you know, that's hard work for a student and a teacher. Not much emotional impact. And emotional impact matters in terms of retention. Then there's the learn by doing, which has almost been eliminated in our university system, but that fact that you do learn by doing things really does matter. And I just don't buy the idea that you're going to learn attitudinal shifts on compliance or sexual harassment or diversity from a flip chart or PowerPoint. It's not going to happen. You have to learn what it's like to really live and experience those things. So VR democratizes experience. It brings any experience you want to your mind, to the learning situation. Okay? It gives you real context. Now we know, the research is really clear here, if you teach something in context, you're far more likely to be successful in applying that knowledge in the real world when you go and apply the knowledge. Transfer of learning, getting it into the real world, and increased retention. All of these add up to you remembering more. I've taken, I don't know, it must be about 50 to 60 VR experiences. I can remember every single one. The sheer intensity is stamped on my brain. I wish I had that experience when I was your age as a student. It took a long time to stamp anything in my brain when I was 19. Let me give you a concrete example of how this can be used in education. I used to teach maths and physics to young kids, and I got invited in at a school to use VR to teach physics, Newton's three laws. This is really hard to teach young kids because they're sort of counterintuitive. So the app I used was free. Download it on a phone, Google Cardboard, and you're floating around the International Space Station in a spacesuit. And it's unbelievably interesting. You look around, you see the stars, you can look at Earth, and this space station is there. And you, boy, do you feel as though you're there. Okay? Now, my first task was to teach the third law, because that's the easiest one. Every action is an equal and opposite reaction. So you get the kid to press the button. It's on a controller. And they go forward, okay? Every action has an equal and opposite reaction. It's sort of weird, that, because there's nothing pushing. You're not pushing against anything there. But it's sort of intuitively you experience that law for the first time, and it sticks. Then you have to explain the first law, because every kid does the same thing. They press it, and they go like this, and they go boom, 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 and they smash into the space station, or they go out in outer space. Why? Because Newton's first law says that if you've applied an initial force, you will go on ad infinitum until another force stops you. That doesn't happen on the surface of the Earth, of course, because cars, air resistance slows you down. And when you explain that to them, they feel it. They really get it intuitively in their gut. They experience Newton's first law. That's a really difficult thing to teach, that law. But experientially, they get it, okay? Then the middle one, you have to explain how the space station got up there. You have to apply a steady force, accelerate this thing beyond escape velocity, get it in there. Then you ask them an interesting question. And I'll ask you this question. Why are the astronauts floating around inside the International Space Station? Any answers? There's normally a two-word answer for that. Any answers?
No gravity.
No gravity? There's what, sorry?
There's no force pulling down.
No force pulling down, right? Any other answers there? No gravity? The normal answer, if you ask that question to 2,000 people, have done, about 1,900 will say zero gravity or no gravity. And it's completely and utterly wrong. It's the very opposite of the truth. Isn't that weird? So the reason if there was no gravity in the space station, the moon would have floated away long ago, including the space station. It's about 89%. Gravity in the space station is about 89% of what it is on the surface of the Earth. That's what holds it in orbit. It's just that the space station is just falling, falling, falling to Earth. And it's always just falling, like a lift falling out of an item. And the guys and women inside the space station are falling with it. So all they're doing is falling. It's got nothing to do with zero gravity. Okay, so you can see how you can really start teaching this stuff using this technology in a way you could never do normally in a classroom from a blackboard. Really powerful experiential learning. And if you wanted to use this stuff in any of your courses, and whenever you get somebody to try VR, it may be an arts course in photography, graphic design, or hardcore physics course, engineering, whatever, good teachers come up with ideas like in minutes. They've got five ideas how they can use this, because you can have just a little 300-buck camera, take a 360-degree picture, high-resolution picture of this room, or a ward in a hospital, anything you want, really. Or you can have moving video. So if you want to do teacher training, I've put one of these cameras in the middle of a classroom with 30 kids and a teacher, and then used the video as feedback to the teachers in terms of controlling the behavior in the classroom. Always a big problem for young teachers. You can come up this ladder by building graphic worlds in 3D Studio. That's not expensive. It takes a couple of days. Actually, most of the graphic components you can download from libraries for free. Entry point's quite cheap for this stuff so far. Then it starts to get a wee bit more complicated because you have to start using tools like Unity or Unreal or whatever. But still, that's fairly straightforward. It's not hardcore programming. And you can come up to this world where at this end here, you can actually use the Vive system, for example, to create 3D sculptures. You put this thing on and you use this wand and you can walk through the sculpture, be in the sculpture. Amazing experiences of creative acts by us. And then this one down here is the hybrid. I don't know if you've ever been one of these Orlando roller coasters, but you can now wear one of those things and experience the roller coaster experience with it on as well. So there's a ladder of increase here, okay? This one's interesting, and this is gender swap. Why is this important? Well, I did this, it's really weird. Okay, so you're a woman, I'm a man. Okay, if you had the Oculus Rift on your head and I had it, you see what I see what you see. You look down, you have a man's body. I look down, I have a woman's body. You can do this with race swap as well. Now, it is the weirdest thing. It's the weirdest thing, because if you're walking around, even though we're tethered, the gait, I see you walking around, and the gait of women is slightly different physically, you know? You start to sort of feel what it's like. It's the weirdest thing. Why make this really matter? Well, I've been working with this stuff in healthcare. If I can put myself in the shoes of a patient, a schizophrenic, for example, if I can experience what it's like to have schizophrenia, a visual defect, torn retina, hearing defect, a missing limb. We've even had experiences recently of paraplegic children who have been wearing a VR set in order to increase their use of robotic legs, and the movement in their legs has come back because the VR has reprogrammed some of that control back into their brains. This was an accidental finding. So there's some wonderful therapeutic and training and job aid applications in healthcare. And if you're at all entrepreneurial and you want to start looking at VR, look at healthcare. There's hundreds of things you can do really quickly and really cheaply here. So if you've got any sort of business mind to you, want to do something wonderful, have a look at that sector. Soft skills training. So once if you go and get a job and you have to do, you know, chairing a meeting and do all that stuff that you have to do when you become an adult like me, then you might want to learn some of these skills as well. And again, AI-driven avatars, all that stuff that if you play games have been there for actually decades, that will come to the training and educational experience as well. And then, of course, there's sentience. AI has really driven this with face recognition, voice recognition, all that stuff is into the mix here. So VR and AR is coming together in a wonderful sort of way to create almost anything you want to simulate in the real world. Attitudinal training, all this stuff. This never works in classrooms. It never works. Nobody learns a damn thing about any of these things by sitting in a lecture theater. Okay? It was interesting when I looked up Penn, I typed in Penn State and AI, and this one came up. Anybody here who's been involved in this project? Because I really like this. It's a teacher training program, so you get a classroom of kids, and you as a teacher, this is an AI-driven program, start to actually manage these kids in a virtual world. Now, this is quite primitive, but VR is getting to a level now where these would look pretty photorealistic if they were actual VR things. Okay. Now, before I go into loads of other real practical examples, I'm going to try and dispel a few myths about AI here, because some things I'm knocking about that are just not right. Okay, so what is this thing, AI? It's many things. This was from the art gallery. I took a photograph of this. Anybody know who this is? Any classical scholars here? No? This is Prometheus. In our culture, when I say our culture, my culture, not the culture of everybody here, in the Western tradition of art, the Greeks come up with Prometheus. Prometheus gets given fire and the ability to make metal by Zeus. And Prometheus makes a big mistake. He gives it to us. He gives it to man and woman. So we become machine makers. We have fire. And Zeus punishes him because he knows this is a bad thing. And maybe given what we saw in the election, maybe it has been a bad thing. So he punishes him to eternal damnation in a way, and by being tied to a rock and an eagle picks away his liver. The Greeks really loved this stuff. But right from Prometheus, we've had a deeply antagonistic dystopian view of technology. It's been in our culture forever and a day. So the big one for my generation were these black and white movies and Frankenstein by Mary Shelley. So in 1818, she writes this book. Look what it's called, The Modern Prometheus. Again, the idea that we create technology or human robotic figures and it comes back to bite us. A dystopian view of technology. I give talks at educational conferences all the time, and I can't tell you how many people seem to just hate the stuff. Like, you know, they hate Wikipedia. Why would you hate Wikipedia? Like, you know, like every single person on the planet uses the damn thing. But, you know, sometimes the educational world hates the very things that may help it the most. But the real origins in our culture is a guy called Capek. The word robot comes from this play by this Czech playwright. And again, it was a dystopian view of the world. The word robot actually means in Czech forced labor. But think about your culture, American culture, and Hollywood, and how it promotes a sort of dystopian view of technology. When you think of technology and robots, you think of robot, you think of Robocop, Terminator, hundreds of those movies you can reel off the top of your head. All of them dystopian. Not all of them. There are some real exceptions to this. But it's pretty weird, this view of the world, in a way, going right back to Metropolis 1927. Because the truth is that some robotics, that's one portion of AI, but most AI is just networked. Now, the movies that did reflect that were certainly HAL 2001. Some of the older people in the audience will fondly remember that movie, quite menacing sort of semi-autonomous thing, The Matrix, of course, and this is a weird one, Her. Anybody seen this movie? Right. The premise, a bit of spoiler here. The guy has an online girlfriend, end of the movie, a million other guys have the same girlfriend. We're all in tears. That's it. But it was an interesting movie because it did show that the Turing test is alive and kicking. And actually, the Turing test, in other words, are we fooled into thinking that a piece of technology is a real living human being, has already been passed by millions of people. If you are on Twitter, how many people are on Twitter? Okay, and if you've got more than 100 followers, a good selection of those 100 will already be bots. You won't know who they are because they're getting pretty good. All it is a little picture, and occasionally it shoots out a tweet. But Twitter's full of bots. Tinder's full of bots. Bots are everywhere now. They're just pieces that you think are real people, which are not really real people. Okay, and that's one of the dangers of this stuff. So AI is already in our culture. It's behind almost everything we see and do these days. An interesting example, of course, is Netflix. And this is interesting at Sundance. If you've watched House of Cards, how many people saw the first series of House of Cards? Right, almost everybody there. Well, what they did is took the scene data from House of Cards, in other words, when we dropped out of it, because they can harvest that data globally and break it down into national cohorts even. They used that data and fed it to the scriptwriters for the series too. So AI is having a role in art. Isn't that weird? I don't mind. If series two is better than series one, I don't give a damn. But it's interesting. Then along comes Sundance, and they feed an AI engine with hundreds of scripts from science fiction, and the AI writes a film script. And they've made this. You can watch this on YouTube. It's called Sunspring, and it's pretty crap, but it's a start. AI-written movies. Pop promos are already doing this. It's commonly popping up, so if you watch that sort of stuff, you'll see it as well, okay? Because there is a big problem. Don't imagine that AI is all about this necessarily. You know, this thing is really rather hopeless. Okay? So it sleeps 8 hours a day. It gets ill. If it drinks a lot, it's almost non-functional for a day afterwards. It gets mentally ill. It has a huge number of cognitive biases. It's sexist. It's racist. It's inattentive. It's always drifting off. And a really fatal objection, it dies. AI never dies. And if I want to transfer my knowledge to Larry's, I can't just download it. And if you have to pick up knowledge, you go to school for about 20 years before you become functional in the real world. Isn't that weird? 20 years it takes. This thing's hopeless. Absolutely hopeless. Okay? This is the stuff here. So AI isn't about mimicking the brain. We don't want to mimic the brain. We want to do better technology. Okay? Because brains are really networks and algorithms and so on. But if you want to teach a brain, your brain, Larry, is a network. And it doesn't respond very well to linear stuff. You know, if I stand here, as I will, for an hour, you'll start to feel a bit weary because it doesn't like long linear stuff. It gets inattentive. It wants to go to Facebook. It wants to be stimulated. So in order to do this, it likes to practice. It likes social stuff. It likes all sorts of things that are often not present in educational experiences. Because AI is not about copying the brain. One portion of AI is a sort of connectivist theory of neural networks, layered neural networks, that area which really has been profound in the AI world in terms of beating Go, DeepMind bought by Google, self-driving cars and so on. But not all AI is like that. And even that doesn't copy the brain directly. It's more analogous to how the brain works. But when I flew up here from Philadelphia, I didn't fly in an airplane that had wings that flapped. We didn't invent flying by copying birds. We invented another form of technology which did it much more effectively, so it flew me across the Atlantic in relative comfort. We didn't go faster by copying the legs of a cheetah, of course. We invented a wheel, a completely different thing altogether. That would have been a bit stupid, trying to rebuild cheetahs, running up and down the freeways on the back of mechanical robots hopping about. That would have been pretty weird. But don't imagine that AI is not about copying the brain, it's about inventing new ways of doing things that are better than the brain. Another interesting thing is that it's just a very recent thing, AI. No, it's not. So the first written algorithm that we have in our culture is Euclid. So 300 BC, seventh book of the Elements, he writes this amazing little algorithm for calculating the factors, the factor of two integers. It's a beautiful little bit of maths, and it's written there right in front of you. Absolute genius. First ever algorithm. Then we have syllogisms, logic, algorithm, the great Arab scholar here, 750-850 BC roughly, who comes up with the concept of an algorithm, who comes up with the concept of algebra, who gives us the numbers that we all have. An amazing achievement. Tell Mr. Trump that one. Descartes, Boole, Frege, Pascal, all these logicians, a whole load of probability theories, 2,500 years of maths before we get to Bayes, 18th century English pastor who comes up with Bayes' theorem, the foundation. There would be no Google without this guy. It's essentially a Bayesian system there, the way which Google still works, in fact. Okay, so to an end, in the modern age, 1956, this was the year of my birth, coincidentally. I had nothing to do with this. But I did go, sorry? It's a good year, yeah. It was the year Elvis hit. Give us rock and roll as well. It's a good side of that year. This is Dartmouth. I went to this college when I was 19, and it still had a sort of air, you know, good on computer programming. The language basic was that's where I picked up computer skills initially. John McCarthy was the leader here, the first big push on modern AI, the foundation of modern AI. But it had its ups and downs since then, because AI was a bit like a rocket ship. They had good maths in the rocket, but it didn't have enough fuel to take off. There was no real applications in the real world. Didn't have enough data. Suddenly we get the internet, you're 2000 roughly, tsunami of data hits the AI world. So it suddenly gave it the juice to take flight. And then we had big advances on machine learning and deep learning, companies like DeepMind and so on, that made it much more efficacious in terms of its practical applications. And of course we had all that jazz on the tech, you know. I can download an app onto my mobile that will beat any grandmaster chess player. You know, this technology really advanced very, very quickly. So it all came together in a perfect storm. AI's here now, and it ain't going away. Resistance is absolutely futile, because all these conditions, necessary conditions, are now met. Now, if you do want to dig a bit of a deep dive and you're not from a maths background or whatever, I really recommend this book called The Master Algorithm, because it lays out the different schools. You know, AI isn't one thing. You know, the top one's connectivist stuff, that's all the sort of neural network stuff. There's the symbolist, the pure reason and math people. Evolutionists, that's a bit like Darwinian evolution. You set off a system that produces lots of variations in algorithms, but the fittest survive. That's had some really interesting successes. Bayesians is all this recalculating probabilities as you get new data going forward. And then this is sort of similar casey stuff. Don't worry about the detail. Buy that book if you're really interested in some more of the detail, though. So I give this talk, and we're going to get 2,500 years of learning theory in 25 minutes, and it's about 110 people. But I'm from Socrates right down to these people down the bottom, all the modern cognitive psychologists or something. But, you know, there's some really interesting new kids on the block here. Remember that Google is nothing but AI. That's all it is. So imagine the idea that we don't use AI in education is patently absurd. It's the biggest pedagogic change I've seen in my entire lifetime. It didn't come from the education departments and universities. It came from a couple of AI kids who were just super smart and used Bayesian theory to come up with PageRank. They've changed the world forever. Salman Khan, interestingly, a mathematician, finance guy, comes out of nowhere and discovers something interesting on his Khan Academy that you don't need faces when you're teaching maths. So you go to a Khan video and it's teaching you, quadratic equations or whatever. I'm not going to learn from his face. I learn from the maths. So he dispensed with the sort of lecturing idea that you have to speak to people to learn maths. No, you don't. Your face is irrelevant to me if I'm learning maths. And most of the MOOCs I take, if I take a MOOC and there's 5 minutes from the academic at the beginning on a talking head, I'm just out of there. You know, it's not going to do me any good. You know, that's not what I want to see. Then we have Sebastian Thrun, I took his MOOC on AI, the very first one, 160,000 of us. Absolutely amazing experience this was. One of the toughest things I ever did in my life. So Udacity, I remember when MOOCs were launched, and I'm in and out of universities, and every audience I presented to myself, never last, it's a fad, blah, blah, blah. How much do you think Udacity is worth today? Billion. 1 billion. That didn't last, did it? And then the Coursera people, both these are AI people, Andrew Nigg, Daphne Kohler, they both came out and did some wonderful things around the Coursera stuff as well. So all this is starting to happen, but this is a new breed, in a sense, you know, in terms of the impact on the learning world. I think all the pedagogic change is actually coming from technology now, whether it be Google and search, Wikipedia of knowledge bases, and especially AI. Why is AI pedagogically so important? Because in machine learning, remember these bits of code learn, They're static. The algorithms themselves are capturing learning theory. So reinforcement learning, which is how you trained the machine to beat the Go champion, was written by Demis Hassabis, who was a games designer. Then he wrote two seminal academic papers on how memory works on reinforcement learning. Then he started a company and sold it to Google for $683 million 2 years later, because he came up with, you could write the algorithms on a piece of A4, $500 million and more, because he discovered some of the secret sauce about things, how things learn. So this is part of our world. We're in an educational institution here. So if you want to look at AI, get really practical for a minute about how you can apply it in the real world, I think there's a sort of five-level thing going on here, a bit like cars. You know, you go all the way up to the sort of self-driving Tesla cars, and sometimes it's just a chip hidden away in the engine, but there are steps in between. The first one is tech. In other words, AI has affected all of your lives, and it affects all of your lives nearly every day. When you go into Google, it determines what you're going to get back as an answer as you type it in. So it has high predictive quality. Amazon, if you're buying books on that, your behavior will have been affected. We know this from Amazon's data. In other words, you will have bought books that they nudged you towards buying. And it's an amazingly interesting area, Amazon's algorithms, because it's not, they don't actually hold a lot of personal data about you. It's all to do with correlations between product sets. So very interesting, if you're interested in the AI side of that, they are absolutely fascinating and the best in the world at that that nudging people to do things. Facebook, of course, you've got the whole algorithmic thing, a lot of controversy around that one in terms of your newsfeed. Netflix, $1 million prize. So Netflix, which has conquered the world. Netflix, you've got to be careful on, because the Netflix algorithm has a bit of evil in it. So the two kids who won the $1 million prize, they won it because it got up to 10% predictive value. In other words, what people would want to watch next. When you're Netflix and those movies come up, you're getting a unique tiling for you as an individual. But it does something quite odd. It gives you a lot of rubbish that they don't pay much money for. So you'll get House of Cards, that'll come up, because they've paid for that themselves. There's no licensing fees. You'll get really third-rate movies popping up now and again in the mix. That's because they don't pay much money for those. You won't get Blade Runner, because it costs a fortune to license Blade Runner. So you've got to be careful with this stuff. You'll be maybe nudged into doing things you don't actually want to do. Sport, of course, Moneyball, soccer is the biggest sport in the world, you know, in my country. Manchester City, a provincial city, big football club, 13 data scientists and mathematicians on their staff. 13. One for transfers, one for training, one for looking at next week's game, one for internal fitness, all mathematics driven, mostly AI driven people. Interesting stuff. Now we've got Tesla, Uber. If you've ever been on online dating systems, of course they're bringing this to bear as well. So the idea that you may want to meet a suitable partner should, in a sense, be determined by what's been successful in the matching before. And that's getting pretty good. Okay, and then, of course, finance at the top there. So PageRank, which made Google, was this. It's a sort of Bayesian thing, but that's how simple it was. This is what gave us a multi-billion dollar company. That simple. Not that simple, because there's loads of variations on this now. Netflix, it was this third thing here that they added on to the end that made them the $1 million, but that was $1 million right there. As a prize, okay? Demis Hassabis, I mentioned that earlier on, DeepMind. All the big tech companies are buying companies like this. They're acquiring smart people coming out of institutions like this who set up AI companies, and that will continue. Because the real source of AI is smart academic work that's been done in these fields, smart students like yourselves who come up with great things. They're not doing it internally. The Google one was interesting because to understand how that type of AI works, you have to understand the nature of the learning within this AI. So you feed it with human data, okay, as much expertise as you can. So that could be expertise on anything. And then the thing plays itself millions of times because it's got the huge processing power of the Google Cloud behind it, huge processing power. It plays itself millions of times and becomes super smart really quickly. Much more quickly than any of your brains could possibly. Even in a lifetime of playing Go, 8 hours a day, you would never get near that number of games. So reinforcement learning, these things get really smart really quickly. They're the new kids in the block. They're the new learners, okay? And they're taking it really seriously, these guys. So the chief exec, Sundar Pichai of Google, we will move from being a mobile company first to an AI first of all. AI Alphabet, Google is an AI company, pure and simple. Nothing more, nothing less. IBM is only an AI company. They bet the whole company on Watson. Everything. Okay, so you can now see how quickly these advances. I remember when the first voice activation systems came in. I have an accent. They were hopeless. Siri was terrible with a Scottish accent. Wouldn't do shit for me, honestly. No matter what I said to it, didn't understand anything. This thing, though, boy, is it good. Because you're getting up to sort of 95%. As soon as speech recognition gets up beyond about 93%, it gets really good really quickly. And we humans see it as a human. This is a thing that will just sit on your table in your kitchen and you can ask it. You can say, I want a pizza, no tomatoes, 13-inch. I want it under $13. I want it in an hour. And the pizza will come to your door because it can understand long, complex sentences through speech recognition. This will come into teaching, as I'll explain in a minute. Alexa, of course, from Amazon. I don't like this quite as much, but it's still pretty good. And then, of course, Apple have been buying up these companies, emotion, in other words, reading emotion in your voice. Loads of companies bundling them up, ready to attack the market as well. So they're all at it here. They're all buying AI companies to make voice, speech recognition, translation work. Samsung have bought Viv. These guys wrote Siri. But this is like Siri on steroids. It's absolutely fantastic. Watch the YouTube demos on this. It understands amazingly complicated sort of Boolean logic type sentences, unpacks them, understands the semantics, and acts upon them. So you can imagine what that's like in terms of healthcare for diagnosis, or the front end of expert systems, as it were. Microsoft are buying this stuff. LinkedIn and recruitment have bought a pure AI company so that they'll be using that for revenues. Or the sales processes and companies, they bought MetaMind. Einstein's their front there. Everybody's at this game now, including these guys. So if you listen to the chief exec of IBM, it's just an AI company. And actually, their moonshot is healthcare. Coming back to them, if you want to do some entrepreneurial stuff, look at healthcare. Over the last 10 years, you've had all these companies over on the left-hand side. Look at the top 10 here, ExxonMobil, General Electric, Gazprom. That's, what year is that? 2006. Jump to now, 2016. Apple, Alphabet, Microsoft, Amazon, Facebook. Actually, AI companies. You know, isn't that weird? And look at the market cap, much bigger than those old companies. But they employ about a quarter of the people that these people did. So huge revenues, less employees, king of the hill. That graph says it all to me. Not going away. As a counterbalance to this, if you're starting to get a bit worried about these, the evils of capitalism, then don't worry, there are some counter prevailing forces. One is Elon Musk, who hired some basketball salary type AI kids right out of university, a lot of them, and set up OpenAI, which is a not-for-profit. So you can go to OpenAI. It's got a really good sort of test rig for algorithms. So you can do all sorts of wonderful things on this now, and that will evolve nicely. And then we have a sort of moral grouping here. I'm not too sure about this, to be honest, but Amazon, Facebook, DeepMind, IBM, Google have got together and said, we're really, you know, worried about these robots killing us in our beds at night. Let's consider the ethics of all this. That's a good thing. But I'm not too sure about the ethics of some of these companies, to be honest. You know, they don't pay much tax. They can behave rather oddly. Okay, this is where it gets interesting. I mentioned Google. I like this team. It's called Chris Beach out of Stanford. Why is this relevant to anybody in this room who teaches or learns? Well, he looked at Khan Academy, which has, you know, thousands of videos that teach maths. The number crunched 1.4 million answers from young kids who were doing maths problems. And what was interesting was that the system they came up through machine learning actually got to 0.85, so 85% accuracy on predicting what that child would do next in the next problem. The system knew exactly what they would answer. Why does that matter? Well, I used to teach maths to kids. And honestly, as a teacher, you've got 30 kids in the room, you have no idea what's going on in their heads. None. It's almost impossible to cognitively diagnose what goes wrong in the heads of somebody who gets even a simple multiply one number, a double-digit number, by one other number. There's about 15, 16 ways that can go wrong. So you can't hold those variables in your head as a teacher, but software can. So this is getting better than a teacher. This is even weirder. Todai Robot Project, nothing to do with robots, out of Japan. So this team here, they build a piece of software with a goal, which is to pass the Tokyo University entrance exam, which is notoriously difficult. They build this system, and all they do is show it the paper. Okay, camera into the system. The semantic analysis, a whole lot of different types of AI, and it comes out, passes the exam with a higher score than the average score of the humans who get into that university. So it's got graduate level knowledge at entrance, okay? Why does this matter? Well, I presume you're at this university, you paid a lot of money to be here, but think about the hypothesis here. If a machine is as good as you now, it's quite likely to be as good at you as you at graduation. That's a worrying thought. So if you're paying several hundred thousand dollars for a degree where a machine may actually do what you had intended to do, becoming a lawyer, law will be one of the first areas that's hit by this because it's a procedural decision-making knowledge with a lot of data mining. It already has been hit. If you look at a book by Susskind on the future of the professions, the number of lawyers is actually starting to fall off now because the lower ends of it are being eaten away by machine technology, and precisely AI. And this is the sort of thing it was doing, grabbing the paper, doing the stuff. Quick question. Well, that's already happening. So the whole game now, this is a big thing. You know, plagiarism checkers? So this university will use Turnitin, or some, every university on the planet uses. That's AI, by the way. So AI is solving the academic problem of students that cheat. But students will also be using AI to cheat and game the system. Students are really good at gaming systems. You're all laughing. You know how to game the system. And that's because the essay is an absolutely stupid and idiotic form of assessment to just rely on essays. Where did that one come from? What do people do? I'll tell you what they do in England. You can go to Oxford and Cambridge, top two universities in England. There are essay writing companies all around those two cities. You can actually look at the turnover in those companies, add up and work out the number of essays that are being submitted as dissertations in those universities. It's an enormous number. This is happening all over the world because we are not keeping up with the necessary changes that we had to in terms of, you know, your point's very interesting here about how this stuff will be gamed, the knowledge, perhaps that students will have a greater knowledge than the academics on this front, and outwit people and so on. It's an interesting area, I think. Here's an interesting piece of assistive technology that every teacher hates, every kid loves. It's called photomaths. Anybody use photomaths here? Photomaths is a little app. So you just show even a handwritten version of a maths problem, you look at it and it comes up with the answer. How cool is that? If you're a kid stuck doing your maths homework as I was long, long time ago, my parents didn't have much maths in them, they weren't gonna help me. Now, teachers hate that because it's just coming up with the answer, but it doesn't. If you press the steps button, it comes up with all the breakdown between the question and the answer, and that's where the real teaching takes place. So when you're teaching kids maths, you have to teach them perseverance, so keep going with those steps, because they get stuck at them. No, keep going to get, the answer is irrelevant. Mathematical thinking is the journey to get there, and this does this sort of stuff, and that's free. Free, on a mobile. Duolingo, out at Carnegie Mellon, this is now up to 150, 160 million. There are, in my country, in England, there are tens of thousands of kids in Spanish, German, French classes. They'll sit there for 8 years, and they won't learn a damn thing. They'll barely be able to ask for a cup of tea or coffee in that language when they leave, because you don't learn a language by sitting in a classroom. Here, we've got 150 million people using what is effectively an AI-driven system, using space practice and so on, and Duolingo. There's about 40-odd languages, 23 plus 23. Market cap of this company, spin out at the university, $500 million. This stuff's here already. You know, learners are doing this for themselves, a completely autonomous system, but a nice bit of assistive technology. Interestingly, when you get to a level in Duolingo, it puts you in touch. Like, I was learning German for about a year in this. When I got a proficiency level, it put me in touch with a real German, so I could then practice the language of that person. It's that gamification system that they had in it. And that was really good. It really helped me a lot there. They've now got a bot type-driven system on the front of it as well, which is interesting. There's an educational version of it. This is the way it's going to go. AI is having a profound effect on language learning. Teaching bots, if you want to understand why technology works so well in botland, read this book, Nassen Reeves from Stanford, and it's called The Media Equation, and it's 35 scientific studies that show that we think of technology as having agency. We think of tech as having your computer, your laptop, your mobile as being a person in a way. So we get angry when it runs out of battery, you know, we sort of kick the car because it's broken down, that sort of thing. But some fascinating work done in those 35 studies. On video, for example, I know if you've been involved in producing MOOCs, don't spend all your money on high-quality video. These guys proved 10 years ago that quality of video doesn't matter. The quality of the audio matters. If it's tinny audio, people get really hacked off. But don't worry, you know, YouTube's full of crap-looking video, but it's still good stuff. We don't want CNN quality video necessarily. That's spending your money on the wrong stuff. All that stuff's in this book. Twitter full of bots. Tinder full of bots. I don't know if you've heard of this example. One of my sons is doing a degree in AI in Holland in Europe, and he sent me a link to this when it first broke the news story at Georgia Tech. So you have 300 AI students, smart kids, sitting there doing their AI degree. They have assignments, mostly project-based, and they have 9 teaching assistants. And the faculty rather cleverly decided to swap one of the teaching assistants out with a bot. And not only were every single one of the 300 students fooled, they thought it was a real teaching assistant, one of them put it forward for a teaching award. Why? Because it was quick. Have you ever submitted an essay in a university or an assignment? How long does it take to get it back? How many of you had it back the same day? When these kids were asking the bot the question, you know the reason they found out it was a bot? It was too quick. It was too quick. It was coming back too quickly. They go, no, that's not right. That never happens in the real world. Fair enough, you know. I'm not blaming teachers for that. You know, if you've got assignments of 300 kids, it's going to take some time. But you can see, and it would only answer things with above 0.97% certainty and probability, so it really did well. But this is the way we can start scaling up. If you've been teaching online or teaching, you know you have a huge admin task. You know it's a bane of your life, the admin side. It's really horrible. You don't want to do it, really. You're a researcher, you're a teacher. We can take some of the pain away from that, I think, if we start using this technology. We have this thing here called Chai Chi, little ice, Chinese. This is a Microsoft bot launched in China, which has had about 500 million. This is older data now. And millions of kids love this. And, of course, the more you use it, the better it gets. So you have to train these bots up by scripting initially. But then, if they're machine learning driven, they start to learn more and more themselves. It's quite interesting. And this is absolutely this has broken the Turing test on a massive scale. You know? So interesting things happen in the real world. This is the bot front end to Duolingo and language learning, where you actually get sort of personalized view of the language. And some weird stuff. Anybody see Tay when it came out? The Microsoft bot. I love this example because all the people my age went apeshit. You know, the newspapers, oh, the end of civilization as we know it. I'm going, calm down. So basically, they launched this bot, and all these kids train it to be a sex-crazed Nazi. Cut to the quick in that one. So they just feed it with loads of weird stuff, and it starts behaving like that because that's how bots work. You know, they're learners, and you can teach them things. That just shows to me that young people are pretty smart, and old people don't really get what AI is. So just waking up, accept this is going to happen, move on. So the real world, we have Cortana, Siri, Viv, Amazon's Alexa, of course, Facebook. You can actually train on Messenger. You can train your own bot if you want to, representing you as a teacher, whatever. And Google at this as well. So bots are here to stay, and they're getting very, very smart. This is a little bot screen I grabbed this morning from a project in this university. So I think it was in the Department of Education. They have a little kid called Eli, who's a bit of an annoying little lad. You know, he swears a lot. He gets really angry in the classroom. He loses it now and again. And they use this to train teachers, because as a young teacher, the last thing you want to do is just sit in lectures for a few years and then get shoved into a classroom with 30 kids who want to kill you because you're teaching maths. So they teach trainers by having this bot, and you can ask it questions. And Eli gets a bit hacked off if you ask him really boring questions. See. Very interesting. All you need to do is, and of course, they'll plan to put a front end on this so you can actually practice what it's like to deal with conflict behavior amongst young people. Really interesting project, this, I thought. With IBM, you can do simulations of driving sim. Really simple thing. This is online already. So you can just ask the car questions, put the radio on, turn them, go faster, go slower. Natural dialogue in sims can come. So you got, if you wanted to think about the Socratic side of teaching for a minute, we can certainly start to think about that. Word of warning, though. I love this bag from a chatbot conference. What do we want? Chatbots. When do we want them? Sorry, I didn't understand your request. You know, they're not that great at sustained dialogue, some of them. But they're getting there. Early days. Okay? Now, here's a project I've been involved in. Imagine if I was involved in the online learning industry for years and built a big company creating online content. Okay? And it had 200 people, and it was floating in the stock market, all that jazz. And we were charging clients $20,000 to $25,000 for an hour of learning, an hour of student time. It's a lot of money. And you can make a lot of money at that one. However, along came a friend of mine, Roger Shank, had a PhD student who started a company over here doing baseball reports, a piece of AI software that would simply write sports reports. And it got so good it was better than real journalists. Why would a piece of AI be better than a real journalist? Because in a baseball game, the AI knew the scores of every single player right back to the beginning of the career. It was in a database. It knew exactly what the weather was, minute by minute, across the stadium. It had narrative acts. It had all that sort of detailed analysis of the direction the team was going in, whether they were going for promotion in the league or whatever. And it just writes the report. Why do people love this? Because we tested them against human beings, and they actually preferred the AI-driven thing. This company now writes finance reports, so on and so forth. Interesting example here in this university, in this project, writing textbooks using AI. That's cool. So right on your doorstep, people are doing this stuff now. If you really want to look at the background learning theory in this one, look at this book by Make It Stick. I'll gloss over this because it's real learning theory stuff, and if you're a student, you may be less interested in that than a teacher. But what I've been working on recently was, give me a document, give me a PowerPoint, give me a podcast, give me a video. That's what most people produce at base in learning. Most teachers produce that sort of stuff. I just shove it into this AI engine. A semantic engine comes up at the bottom, looks at this stuff and goes, that's what the student needs to know, that they need to know that, and that, and that, and it creates the online learning experience, okay, using AI. And it's pretty good, this thing, it's spotting. I did a little course on Penn State University this morning. We're sitting there doing it, you know, how many students, all that jazz. And then at the end, not only does it get you to, it does fill in the blank type stuff, which is far superior to multiple choice questions, which are not very good in this stuff. As you're doing stuff, and maybe the AI says, this is a course for nurses. I don't know what negative control is. It comes up with a link automatically out to Wikipedia on the scientific method and control. So as you're doing the course, the AI is keeping an eye on what you it thinks you know or haven't got, and comes up with links to supplementary material if it thinks you don't quite get that concept. So the course is like porous around the edge, okay? So it goes off to Wikipedia. It can even create e-learning in real time on Wikipedia. At the end, you have to get 100%. Why do you think you don't get 80% of the test? Why is that a dumbass idea? Well, if you're a nurse and I'm training you on how to recognize the symptoms of a young baby with fever, if you only know 80%, the other 20% is going to kill somebody. So in loads of contexts where this learning is necessary, 100% competence matters. And this thing will drill you around. If you get things on amber or red, it will drill you past to your 100% competence. It doesn't stop there. It then goes to IBM Watson and looks at, like, the one I did in Penn State last night. Take 5 minutes, put the text in from Wikipedia, gives me a course in Penn State. And it came up with quite interesting things, like the creamery. I have no idea what your creamery is, but it was quite interesting. I click on creamery. Wow, interesting stuff. Your stadium. I know nothing about American football. I'm a basketball guy. But boy, is football big here. So I, as a learner, suddenly get all that supplementary material at the end of the course produced by Watson and a piece of AI. I don't need a teacher to, it will go and find the useful stuff for me, whether it's medicine, engineering, or whatever. Then it does something interesting, spates practice. Right, you've been listening to me for some time. And let me tell you something that's a scientific fact, that you will have forgotten almost everything I've told you by tomorrow, because the brain is a forgetting organ. Ebbinghouse in 1885 showed us the curve. You'll be down to about 50% before the end of the day. At the end of the month, you're down to about 20%. That's only if you take notes. Okay? So how do we solve that problem? This is why most learning is a bit foolish. We're just teaching people to forget. What students do is go away, take notes, and then you revise, you cram, you do all that stuff. You do spaced practice, okay? But hardly any educational systems do that for real. I don't know why. But you can certainly do wonderful things if you can, okay? Moving on to analytics, you might want to think that you might, what sort of knowledge would I want about you as a student before I start on one of those systems? I might want to know your learning style. No, I don't, because they don't exist. Learning styles are bullshit. They do not exist. Let me repeat that. The science shows that learning styles don't exist. You might want to know Myers-Briggs data, you know, that personality stuff. That's a Ponzi scheme. Forget about that one as well. Just not scientifically valid. Okay? You might want to know about big data. Forget about it. You have no big data in this university. You have small bits of data in your courses. You've got limited numbers of students. It's tiny data compared to Google. Don't be sold the predictive analytics game there. Big data doesn't matter. What you need is individual data about your students as they progress through courses and aggregated data from other students, perhaps outside the institution. Okay? But the big one here is adaptive learning. A completely different view of AI. And here, everybody gets educated uniquely. So ASU, Georgia Tech, various other places, I've been involved in projects using this technique. So you do a course in biology, American history, whatever. But the course tracks you a bit like a GPS. So the AI is your GPS. If you go off course a little bit and you get lost in the middle of the Civil War and didn't quite understand the role of X, Y, and Z, it knows that and gets you back on track again. It knows what destination you've got to get to. But it replaces, it doesn't replace teachers. These systems work superbly well with experienced teachers who get the data about the students as well at the same time. Okay, because if you're teaching maths, my subject, by and large, these courses are ridiculously linear. that's how they're presented and taught. Maths is more like this in the real world, and there's loads of like pitfalls here. This is why most kids fail at maths. What you have to do is create a whole load of probability dependencies between objects in a network, and every individual goes through these networks differently with this GPS guiding you through. That's adaptive learning, folks, and that's been used in lots of universities around the world. Increase in attainment, dramatic correlated drop and dropout. Do students like it? Look at the blue and green here. They love it. They want it in other courses. In MOOC land, if you've ever taken a MOOC, a massive open online course, I hate MOOCs where it gets drip-fed like a 10-week semester, treat me like an 18-year-old undergraduate. You know, I'm a 50-year-old adult. I don't want to wait till next week while you give me the next bit of reading. You know, I'm out of that course straight away. You have to, it's a completely different model here. MOOCs have to be more flexible. We built one on dementia, and look at the pattern, people. Some people did it all in a day. Others did module 6 back to module 1. Some people jived around the place. This is how you have to design learning experiences in this day and age. You have to free yourself from the tyranny of time and location. Okay? Go back to this report. Even for practical skills, if you're an expert, you want to get your expertise into the heads of a novice, then read this report and these case studies out of the US Navy in this case. You have something, a 16-week course that will do what takes years to do otherwise using intelligent tutoring. Okay, online assessment, all this stuff is coming. We'll be doing our exams online because it can do Irish recognition. If you do a Coursera course, you type in a type, you type in a paragraph at the beginning. It knows the pattern of your typing, so when you come to take the exam, it knows it's you. You've now got FaceTime recognition, real-time face recognition, so when you do the exam, rather than having your brother or sister with big cards on the other side of your PC while you sit the exam, it knows whether you're cheating. It's doing sentient analysis to see whether you're puzzled or not. Some smart things to see whether you're cheating or not on this front. Automated essay marking. There will be some people who have had their whole lives ruined by having piles of essays to mark at Christmas. If only I had a few more papers to grade, said no teacher ever. This is why you have all this stuff as well. This is all AI driven. Of course, AI will come to this debate we had earlier from a very good question from the lady in the audience here. So it's hitting us big time. Anybody know what blockchain is? No? Okay. Bitcoin? Heard of Bitcoin? Okay. So Bitcoin, an amazing currency. You can go and trade it against the dollar. People make big money on this. It's a real currency, and the underlying technology is a database structure called blockchain. It has no centralized ledger. Okay, why does this matter in education? Because you come here because you trust the brand of this university, and when they give you a degree, that's an act of trust, and they store that somewhere in a ledger, and you use it to get a better job. But is that truly necessary in the future? I got married on blockchain this year. Remarried, I should say. Okay, so me and my wife went up to an iPhone, and we paid in Bitcoin, and our second marriage got stored on blockchain, and it's a distributed database, and it's unhackable, secure, and will be there forever. So it's all about storing trust, because that's all universities do. They give you degrees, and then they store that thing, and then you use it later. They do a lot more. They teach you, of course. So this whole centralized clearinghouse may give way to a more distributed, almost Napster, you know, the way file sharing works on the web. That may be a big thing in education. There are already people doing this. Space practice, loads of tools available. The forgetting curve. This is where you're going to be. You're going to forget it all down to 21% after 30 days, folks. That's dramatic. How do you solve that problem? You have to hike people up by giving them practice over time doing this. Smart maths. The reason I can do this to you as a student, I've got an algorithm that says you as a student, you did your learning experience here. You're going to have an exam here. Between now and then, I've got to reinforce in a logarithmic fashion. And I interleave the data, the things you didn't know, nearly knew, and I interleave them using good maths. And then if you do have a day off, or you go out to the bar, have a hangover, I know you're missing that day. I don't give you a huge load here. I take that and I spread it like jam or butter across the future. That's all done by good maths. And I do it to your mobile. That's how, you know, we now have an umbilical cord to our students through their mobile devices. Don't put e-learning courses on mobile devices. Nobody does e-learning on mobile devices. You know, use it for everything else but learning. Use it for space practice and other stuff. I think that really this is, social media is all about this as well. And then finally, we've got this whole autonomous thing. Don't worry about this, a lot of detail here. I think this is going to be huge, but it can go wrong. It can go wrong. And two good books here. This is a more academic book, but this is a sort of potboiler, Cathy O'Neill, who has about 10 chapters and examples of where the algorithmic view of the world can lead us astray. Read them if you will, because inputs, algorithms, we can have bad data, bias, and all sorts of things. But by and large, I think algorithms are pretty good. It's really difficult to make a racist algorithm. You have to work hard as a programmer to make an algorithm racist, but we are all racist. It's hard to make an algorithm sexist, but it's not that difficult to feed it racist or sexist data. You can use this stuff badly. It very rarely is intrinsically bad, and it's up to us to keep an eagle eye on this stuff because it can be gamed. There's bias. Let me give you an example on the university ranking systems. I don't know where Penn is. But believe me, your ranking systems are a bunch of mathematical nonsense because they all use proxies. They don't use real data at all. They don't know anything about the quality of teaching in your institution. They don't even know how many students attend lectures. They don't know, there's no real raw data. And they don't include costs. Imagine coming up with a ranking system where they don't include the fact that it costs $100,000 a year here and $10,000 there. That's just stupid. In other words, algorithms can be gamed, and of course, the presidents, the universities game those algorithms all the time. Let's have a new football stadium. Yeah, that's great. Well, hey, we shoot up the ranking system. So the danger of this stuff is that you get to know how the algorithms work and you start to game it. Okay? And this is the last thing here, right? Sorry, I've been so long. I'm nearly at the end, folks. We're coming up here. Okay, sorry, we're human performance flatlining. By and large, our brains are limited in their capacity. We're not getting any better at anything. You know, the Olympics, we got another centimeter and jumping, running, whatever. But by and large, AI is growing exponentially. We're about here, but some things we've shot through that line here. And there's some really serious reports now looking at up to 47% job losses, by and large, in white-collar work, not necessarily blue-collar work. This is really deeply worrying. Okay? As I said at the beginning, I think we now are morally bound to look at AI for solving some of those problems if it's going to cause us problems, and that it both creates as it destroys. I'll end on this one because a whole load of books here. We're at a university, and if you want a deeper dive, want to know about AI, use that one. This is more texty. This is Norvick and Russell, standard textbook in the area. Homo Deus, a really good book on, really readable book in terms of the future of AI, Rise of the Robots, Why Algorithms Can Be Evil. And these are more sort of academic books, a more deep dive into why algorithms can be evil, the future of the professions, why lawyers and accountants are in real danger of not having any jobs in the future. This is really worrying because you've got two law schools here. But believe me, it's not necessarily certain that the demand for lawyers is going up. In fact, I would say it is certain that the demand will fall. Superintelligence, all about how big and weird this becomes when they become really, really super smart. Okay, some reading there. A bit of a worrying way to end in a way. But thank you very much for listening, and hopefully I can answer any of the questions you've got about the morals or structure of this stuff. Thank you very much for listening. We've been coming along today. I really
appreciate it. Please join me. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Donald. So, We want to get questions, interactions with Donald, but I know we've got questions online. So let's start with Brad.
Hi. So one of our online participants, Meng Su, asks, well, I'll just read it verbatim. Hi, this is Meng Su from Penn State Barron. Very interesting speech. The current online teaching in universities is still almost flat, two-dimensional.
Yep.
Creating AI, AR, VR content in the teaching materials is difficult. Any examples, general products in this area that you're aware of? What skills are most demanding in creating this content?
Okay. Well, when you're creating content, there are two things. You know that thing Wildfire I showed you? That's really easy. So if you as an academic have some basic source material, PowerPoint, video, text, just give me it, and I just cut and paste it in, and it works. It takes minutes to create a course. The second thing is on adaptive learning. Remember that GPS thing I showed you, where you've got this like thing that's guiding you through the course? Those companies that sell that, the ASU work, They have a front-end system for the teacher or academic to build the content or repurpose their content so that it can be used by the system, because you have to take your content, break it down into chunks, and then work out the logical dependencies between those chunks. So if you're going to teach multiplication, you really have to know subtraction and addition. There's a dependency there. So you work out that logical structure, and hey presto, the system takes care of the rest. So there are some good commercial packages right now that help you as a teacher prepare your material for AI-driven content, if that was what the question was about.
Questions? Here we go.
Hi. So I, if I think of AI, the first thing that comes into my mind is I can play chess against a PC. And I can even set it like if I want it to be hard, difficult, or easy. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to ask you, like, how do you think how far AI has come, from the beginning until now?
Well, chess is an illustrative example. So we had Deep Blue in the 90s, which hammered Kasparov, and that was the big breakthrough there. But by and large, that used brute force, to play chess. What's interesting is that really good chess players use heuristics, and they use an algorithmic approach now to play chess, and that started to happen now. So it's a perfect example, gaming. So checkers, that was the first breakthrough. That was way back. In other words, an AI program will beat every single human being on the planet at checkers. It will now beat every human being at chess. Go is a much more complicated game than chess. Way, way beyond. Orders of magnitude more difficult. And it can now beat that. And remember, DeepMind, all you do is show it a game. You literally put a camera in front of a computer game, and it learns by just observing the rules of the game, and then it learns how to play the game. And then it becomes better than you as a human being. Isn't that absolutely amazing? So we've learned a lot. AI has advanced a lot because of chess and game playing, because it's one of the most sophisticated and difficult things our minds attempt to do. If it can conquer that, God, think of the other things it's going to conquer. Being a lawyer is trivial sometimes, Well, certainly some aspects of being a lawyer may be trivial. Good question.
Hey, Donald. Oh, got one back here?
Hi, I'm a former teacher, and my question is the cost. Mm-hmm. And putting it in the public school system, how do you get the public school system, which is fueled by taxes coming from the public, to pay for the technology that would make the classrooms less flat?
Yeah. Well, the cost thing is variable. So first of all, we have Google, which is free. We have Wikipedia, it's free. We have open source stuff, it's free. So Anki, my kids use that university, free, open source. So there's a whole layer of stuff that's free. That can be nothing but a good thing in the public school system. And of course, every learner in the world, every kid in school uses Wikipedia. That's a fact, but it's free. We often forget about that and think everything has a cost. Coming up that ladder slightly though, what is the cost of having dropout? What is the cost of a second year undergraduate here failing the exam and getting thrown out with 2 years of debt around their neck? The cost for that individual is catastrophic. For the federal government who's holding the loan at $1.2 trillion, it's catastrophic. So I think if AI is going to solve some of those hotspot problems, it will be a good thing, but it's a return on investment model. You're absolutely right. We've got to be really careful in this. But this stuff is, remember, it's all about scale. So I go to Africa every year. And not, like, you're all sitting here very comfortably in this place. Hardly any people your age in Africa even think about going to university. There isn't a chance in hell of any of them going to university in the countries I visit, because nobody's going to pay the fees you pay here. So if we think that this model, building these things, is a solution to world education, think again. It's not going to happen. And your prices have been going up and up and up. That's unsustainable.
Well, that was the next point I wanted to make, too, is that, the school system might fuel the cost for the teachers to use it, but how do you get the technology in the hands of the kids who need to respond through technology to what the teachers are teaching?
The technology is in the hands of every kid anyway, so you have absolutely universal penetration of smartphones in young people anyway. Nobody doesn't have a smartphone. And those smartphones are as powerful as desktop computers were just a few years ago, so they can do, almost all AI can be delivered through that, and even cheap VR. You're talking about a $5 piece of cardboard to do Google VR. This is not expensive stuff. Some of these headsets are about $70. They're consumer products. So look at the consumer market for solving that problem. It's a good question, this, because I as an investor, always look at consumer behavior. So if kids have all smartphones, $70 is nothing for somebody who's got a $500 PlayStation or Xbox. look at those trends, because they will have the technology. They'll sort that out for you. The school needn't buy that stuff. You know? That's why I don't like tablets in schools. I think it's absurd putting tablets into secondary schools. If I was a student, I would be buying a laptop. You know? You can't do anything on a tablet, you know? You can't anybody write an essay on a tablet?
Well, yeah, and your school systems are still pretty restrictive as to what technology it will allow the students to use.
Well, yeah, and the mistake is they buy a lot. I think this is old people my age buying technology that kids don't really want. You know, like if you're going to use Photoshop, you're going to be coding. You're not going to be doing it on a touchscreen tablet. You're going to be buying one of these things.
Thank
not
you.
All good, the technology thing. You know, we've got to be careful with what we do with this stuff.
So
I'm on your side in that one, believe me.
Hi. So you talked about VR and how important it is to be immersive, to be actually learning something. What do you think about AR?
Yeah, I just didn't have time to cover the other thing. I'd be here all day. I'm a bit, you know, I played with both a lot, HoloLens and so on. I'm a wee bit nervous about AR as being a solution because it's a bit, I often think it seems to me like Pepper's Ghost, that old Victorian illusion thing. So you suddenly get these things floating around out here and you can grab them from midair. And after, you know, after 5 minutes now, I'm just bored. You know, like VR, completely different ballgame, because that takes me into another form of consciousness and another world. Completely transforms my brain. My whole brain screams at me going, you're there, Donald, you're in outer space. HoloLens doesn't do any of that, but it will have practical applications on maintenance and engineering where you have to layer stuff on top of machinery and so on, but I think it's niche. So I walked around for a while with Google Glass in my hometown, being ridiculed by members of the public. I was determined to do it, you know. It wasn't that great, actually. It sort of put me off AR a little bit. But I think you'll get a mixture of the two. You know, it will find its place. But I would put AI at the top. That's got breadth and reach in time. VR is a niche thing that will have a bit of breadth and reach because it will be with us forever as a new medium. AR sort of will hobble along, I think, a little bit. Microsoft would hate this if I was saying this, but because they bet a lot of money on HoloLens. Is that okay?
So we have a...
Okay. Can we say that AI would be more intelligent than the creator?
Oh, yeah. Well, it's interesting. The word intelligence, you've got to be really careful of big abstract nouns like intelligence. There's a very good paper called The Extended Mind by Clark and Chalmers. And they have a very interesting idea, which I buy, which is the word intelligence is an anthropomorphic term. In other words, when you say somebody's intelligent or have multiple intelligences, these are human qualities, okay? If you redefine intelligence as just the function of a network, okay? So anything beyond three in a network will have an emergent quality. It will be smart in a sort of way, like your smartphone is smart. You know, it can beat you at chess. And I think this notion of the extended mind, or sometimes called panpsychism, the idea that any network has as an emergent quality, intelligence, I would prefer to use the word competence. I think the word intelligence from iSync onwards has been incredibly dangerous, this idea that intelligence is just the application of pure reason. Even Gardner's multiple intelligence is pretty hokey theory, really. It just happens to match the school curriculum. Bit suspicious there. I think we have to think of intelligence as being a feature of networks. And there are a few theorists working in this area, but I sort of buy that line of inquiry. In other words, avoid anthropomorphizing the word intelligence or competencies. Machines will simply be better than you at loads of things. Doesn't mean to say they'll be intelligent in the sense that they're thinking. IBM Watson beat the two world champions at Jeopardy, but it didn't know it had won. It didn't know it had won. It isn't intelligent in the sense of being a conscious being that had self-reflection. But it hammered them at Jeopardy. It's a different form of intelligence.
I know we have a couple online questions. Brad?
First, Jade online asks, or says, we've seen a lot of VR development in gaming in particular. What do you think is the area that VR will develop most in the next 10 years? Will it be
VR?
Education, gaming, entertainment?
Well, it will be phased because the first big win for all these companies is gaming. So, and it depends on the platform. So, of course, PlayStation, pure gaming VR platform. They're all going after the gaming market because they're the first buyers of this stuff, and games are amazing in VR. And if you want to play a really weird game, you know the movie Paranormal? Well, there's a game out in Paranormal, and I have seen people on their knees crying with fear in VR in that game. It is such an astonishingly terrifying experience. It's freakishly frightening. Now, I like that. I love those movies. I'm a jumper in the cinema. You know, my wife hates that. But I love that adrenaline thing. And so you get oodles of that. So that will drive the market. In education, I think vocational learning, learning to do things, will be the big win in that one. Also, lab work and physics, the sort of stuff I was talking about where you have to actually do things to learn, that's obviously a big win. And there are some subjects more amenable to that than others. Yeah, you know, I don't see it as being great in the philosophy department.
Brad, do you want to do another one? Let's go
to healthcare
as well.
Thank you very much. I come from creative industries, and my question will be related to something you have presented earlier. Basically, all of this is based on fed data and algorithm. Mm-hmm. How do you see connection between developing the generating the creative concepts? Is that future of AI? And if you can say a little bit more about democratization of education through these tools, because that's inevitably coming. Thank you.
Yeah, let me answer the second bit first, the democratization of education. It's terribly important for me. One of the reasons I go to Africa is every year is I have a sort of political view of this, which is it really matters. And it's easy to sit in ivory tower universities as people who are coming from relatively wealthy backgrounds and ignoring that problem. But when you ignore problems, you get things like happened 2 days ago in your election. If you ignore social problems, you will get big problems in the future. We have the decentralization, democratization, and disintermediation, three different things in education. Okay, it's already happened. Let's take a really simple example like Wikipedia. So you have that crowdsourcing of the biggest knowledge base we've ever had in the history of our species, and it's a wonderful thing. And I've met Jimmy Wales, and I think he should get a Nobel Prize for what he's achieved there. It's a wonderful thing because it's free, and kids in Africa can get it on even basic phones because it's free tariffed by the telcos. So that's the democratization. And you've disintermediated the booksellers, the publishers, the people who scrape all the money and profit out of the system. I think that will be a good thing in answer to your question earlier. I think if we want to lower the cost of education, whether it's higher education, school education, adult education, vocational education, technology is the only answer because it's the only thing that gives us scale. Your first question was about the sort of creative process. It always worries me, the word creativity, when it's used because, and I've worked in the arts and been involved in that. When you use the word creativity in education, Sir Ken Robinson's the big sort of guru on all this, and I don't buy Ken Robinson's stuff. Ken's never taught anybody. I know Ken. And he tells loads of jokes, and he rattles on and uses the word creative and creativity all the time. But if you've ever been a teacher and walked into a class with 30 kids who don't want to learn maths, Ken Robinson ain't much use to you. That's the truth of the matter. We have to get more serious about education and the process of teaching and learning theory and using this stuff in anger. There's nothing wrong with direct instruction. You know, I don't buy the whole collaborative social construction thing that we all learn all the time in groups. I don't think so. You know, put four 13-year-old boys in a maths class in a group and three of them will just hang around the side loafing away while one does all the work. So on the creativity thing, though, I think I've seen some marvelous things in AI already where we've had music. There's some very interesting work done in the States by a guy who produces Bach music using an AI engine. And he did an amazing thing. It was in Chicago, I think, where he played the AI piece of Bach, a piece written by Bach, and then this other academic challenged him, thought AI couldn't write music that would fool human beings, and he put his piece of music in. And of course, they polled the audience at the end, and they got it all wrong. They thought that the AI was actually Bach, and it was, everything was flipped. So even in the production of high-end creative, in that case, music, classical music, AI can do amazing things. Because it does what the human brain does. It takes sort of historical themes in music and brings them together. So there's some really good examples of like jazz-produced content with a sort of poppy feel to it and so on. Loads of people are doing work in that area. Does it pass the Turing test? It does, because you think it's good. New forms of intelligence. You know this question, what intelligence? Machines can be intelligent, and if machines can also be creative, I think, why not? Just because they're not conscious doesn't mean to say that the end product, depends what your view of aesthetics is. Is it to do with the creator or the object itself? If, like me, you have a theory of aesthetics which is to do with the object and not the creator, then AI is fine by my book.
So we have another question. I'll combine a few questions on here. One of the traditional understandings is that new technology replaces jobs, but create new jobs through that technology to absorb the resulting unemployment. how can we best be preparing our students and, you know, future individuals within the job market for this AI-driven future?
Well, that question contained a big problem, because it's true that technology creates new jobs, but it doesn't create as many jobs as it destroys. The net result is less jobs. This is why Trump won. Let's be clear on this. So there are less jobs. That's a fact. In fact, it's going to accelerate. There will be fewer and fewer jobs going forward. Okay, so I think that's just a basic economic fact now. In Southern Europe, and listen to these statistics for a minute, in Portugal, Spain, Italy, and Greece, you have 40 to 50% youth unemployment. Listen to what I just said there. 40 to 50% youth unemployment. Half of this room would be no job. 20 to 28% unemployment amongst adults. This is just a pot ready to burst because industry has been wrecked there. The German economy has soaked up the cash. They're trapped in a currency they can't escape from. The economics is clear. The net number of jobs is catastrophic in those countries, and it's not going away. Greece has a $300 billion debt that will be there in 20, 30, 40 years' time. So what's the solution to this? Again, I go back to, we have to start looking at technology to solving that problem. Maybe accept the fact that we'll have structural unemployment. So Switzerland recently had a vote on the basic income for all citizens. I think that's sensible. Why demonize people? If you're working in a mine in Pennsylvania and they just take the mine away, you can't demonize the miners for being lazy. It's stupid. You have to recognize that they no longer have some work, but they're real human beings with other aspirations. The training thing was the final portion. It's so important that we start using technology to train people quickly into new industries. Really important. It won't solve the problem, but when you lose your job, get that person back into employment by reskilling quickly. And that doesn't mean going back to college for 3 years. That's too late, too slow. It means doing it quickly. So I think technology holds the key to some of those problems.
So I think we probably have time for one more question.
There was somebody put their hand up.
Is there another one? Yep.
Hi. So maybe this is kind of a lofty question. I don't know. But
okay.
So I'm thinking about like some classes that I'm in where I have to like solve certain integrals, right? And they say, oh well, you know, once you get to like a certain problem set, they're like, just use MATLAB. Like it's okay. It'll solve it for you, right? And and I think about how we're like using AI to educate ourselves, but at the same time, AI can solve these problems.
Yeah.
Like I just wanted to know your thoughts in terms of like, isn't there sort of redundancy there? That's kind of.
This is a really interesting question for me. I've taught maths in the past, because there is a tendency to hang on to the idea that maths is about calculation. Okay, when I grew up, the calculator was the only thing. There was no computers and so on. So you're learning math. And there was a huge emphasis on mental arithmetic and calculating stuff. And you go, well, why would you do that? You know, like machines do that much, much better than any human being. So in a sense, relying on that type of mathematics, as opposed to mathematical thinking, I think is a big mistake. In other words, we should be making it easy for students to just mechanically do what they know has to be done. There's another theorist called Wolfram here. Do you know Wolfram Alpha? So the guy behind that, he's big on this. He thinks that we should completely flip mathematics training away from the, you know, the labor of calculation and 10 years of kids struggling to do things. Like I taught maths, and I would teach them quadratic equations. Every kid in England has to do this, quadratic equations, thirds. They're never going to use a damn thing. You know, I'm 59 years old. I've never used Pythagoras' theorem. I've never used a quadratic equation, a third. It's completely ridiculous. The maths Taliban that want every kid to become an expert. What on earth is that about? That's just dumb. It will solve none of our problems. And, you know, I know maths people. That's my world. But believe me, if I've got a problem in my life, I'm not going to my friend who's a professor of mathematics to get it solved anytime quick. They're not very good at life problems necessarily, but they're brilliant at other things, and I love and admire them. So we have to get away from, you know, that rigidity in subjects as well. I quite like courses which are cross-curricular now. So, you know, a good example, one reason my son went to this university in Holland to do an AI degree is they do a course in cognitive psychology, they do a business course. It's a rounded thing, because that's what all this is about. It's about understanding how the brain works and how you're going to apply it there. It's about maybe going out in the real world and taking your knowledge and doing something for good, or being an entrepreneur, or whatever. I think that's what we have to look for in education, as opposed to these subject silos all the time. I don't know if that answered your question. You know, there's a really interesting thing here, though. The danger in making it too easy. So if AI comes along and it makes it really easy for students and you're not challenged enough, if that's behind your question, which it may have been, that may be a real danger, that you sort of lose that, you know, that gutsy, oh, I'm going to get this done, you know, that you've been there, and so suddenly you solve that equation at midnight and you go, wow, that was great, you know, I really did that. Maybe we're stripping some of that away because AI will make it too easy, which makes your question even more interesting, I think.
So before, when you were talking about the college educated people and things like that, what if it was possible to quickly, what if people didn't have to go to college? So we just quickly taught people like a task.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, in England, where I come from, only 46% of kids go to college. US is quite unusual. Majority of kids go to college because you don't have really a big vocational path in your educational system. In Germany, only about 30-odd percent. Germany is the most successful, one of the most successful economies in the world. Easily the most successful economy in England. But actually a relatively small number of people go to college in Germany because they've got a spread of opportunities for kids. So the kids who want to become engineers, anything, you know, there's always a route. And it's regarded as a sensible and reasonable thing. I think we've lost that. So in answer to your question, I think we're going to have to swing the pendulum back that way, because a college degree, once everybody's got it, is, as Marx would say, it's commoditized. So the value drops. But you've still got a student loan, but you don't have a salary that will ever pay for it. Not only that, you can't buy a house because you're saddled with debt. So I think that's coming home to roost a bit. It has in Europe already. I wouldn't hazard a guess here. I don't really know enough about the American landscape. But I think this is, you know, it's a vicious loop now that we're in, because the costs are being driven up. That's why my appeal to institutions like this is you have to start working at lowering costs here. This is no longer sustainable to just add another $10,000 a year. It's just not sustainable. And it's not right. You should stop, you know, stop building these buildings. You know, really, cut the capital budget. There are online options here. You're smart. People your age know this stuff. You know? You can free yourselves from the tyranny of time and location in learning.
Terrific, Donald. I have a... Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Pete.
One more.
History of the last century and the increase in economic equality, what do you base your optimism on?
Well, a wing and a prayer. I'm not particularly optimistic. I think the danger is that we believe we're producing equality when we're not. I think the interesting thing that happened in Europe with my country and also with your election is there was an illusion that equality was hitting everybody, and it was a lie. Because people were suffering, but they were hidden. They didn't have a voice. The media, the establishment, everybody thought that everything was hunky-dory down there, and these were just stupid, dumb, ill-educated racists. Not the truth. And in Europe, exactly the same thing. Actually, what was happening was massive inequalities were being created by technology. So I'm hugely pessimistic, but I think resistance is futile. I'm only optimistic because I think if we get our fingers out of our pockets and get on with it, we may have a chance of using technology for social good in schools, in healthcare, and massive. Those are the two big costs in your system, the government. If we can half the costs in those, we will massively reduce inequalities because most of it's chasing your tail. Those blue-collar workers who lost their job, healthcare is a big issue for them, as is education. You know, they've lost hope that their kids are going to go to a top league college now because it's just too damn expensive. And so even the higher education system, I think, is starting to produce we think it's a social good, but it may actually be producing or increasing social inequality, but we don't realize it. And people here are good people. They don't want to do this, but it may be happening without us realizing it. That's the lesson we need to take from the recent elections. But use the technology for social good. Scale. Don't be frightened of it. Embrace it.
Well, you gave us a lot to think about here. And my guess is we could continue the conversation, but we're going to draw it to a close. Please join me online and face-to-face in thanking Donald for his talk. I would like to think we're probably just entering this dialogue, right? I mean, this is going to be, as you say, something to consider whether you love it or like it. It's here to stay. So yeah. Thank you for joining us, Donald.
No problem.
Thank you all for being with us this afternoon.
You.